So I thought the way I would do this is I would start, of course, with kind of very low dimensional space, just the line, and then I would work up to the plane, and then three-dimensional space, and then four, and so on like that. And the main goal I have for the talk is I want to explain or get you, I want to kind of explain this four-dimensional thing called the 24 cell. So all the things I'm going to talk about, it's going to look like it's kind of meandering along, but I'm hoping to get to the point where you'll see and like this four-dimensional thing called the 24 cell. So I'll start out slow with the line. So so there are two ways to think about the line, and maybe just for a marker, I'll put a dot here and put a zero on it. One way to think about the line is, of course, it's just the line as I've drawn it, and it's supposed to stretch out forever. But another way to think about it is that you could think of the line as just all the numbers. So if I say a number like one, I have to get some scale, so maybe I'll use feet. So there would be where one is, and if I wanted to know where say three was, it might be about over here. And if I wanted to have minus one or say minus 1.5, it would be about here. So somehow the line, thinking of the line as a geometric thing and just thinking of it as a collection of all the numbers, they're really equivalent in a way. And one reason, the thing about thinking about it when you draw it on the blackboard is that you can see it. You can use your eyes to appreciate what the line is like. But if you think about it in numbers, just in terms of numbers, in a way you can think about it blind. Like, I'll give you an example. Say you wanted to know how far was the point 1 from 3. Well, one way to do it is you would take, 3 minus 1. So it's a distance from 3 to 1. So if you want to know the distance between any two numbers, you don't have to draw them on the line. You can just subtract the smaller one from the bigger one, and then that's your answer. So I'm going to, maybe I'll write down a little formula. This is maybe the most complicated way in the world to write this. Well, I'll write it in two ways. You could say that the distance Well, I'll call the first point, maybe for later, I'll say the first point is x1. Well, OK, from x to y is, well, so in other words, if y is bigger, you subtract off x. And if x is bigger, you subtract off y. Another way to write this, you could write it like this. And I'm going to do this because later I want to talk about what happens in higher dimensions. What you can do this is a little trick. If I take x minus y, let's say x minus y was equal to minus 3. When I square it, I get 9. And then when I take the square root, I get 3. So this idea of squaring a number and then taking a square root, it's a little trick for getting rid of a minus sign, you could say. So in case you don't know what a square root is, it's the thing that undoes squaring. You multiply a number by itself, like 5 times 5, you get 25. Square root of 25 is 5. So anyway, this is a kind of a formula for the distance from points on the line. There's not too much else to say about the line. If you want to draw things in the line, you could maybe draw an interval or two intervals or many intervals or some more complicated thing. But these individual things are fairly simple. Well, that's all I wanted to say about the line. If you go up to the plane, there's kind of more scope for exploration. So in the plane, so maybe maybe I'll say, I'll call this the line. So, you could just think of visually, you could think of the blackboard as the plane, and I've drawn this cross in it just as a kind of a marker. And so here I'm kind of putting a dot, which I'm going to label 0, 0. And another way to think about the plane is that it's pairs of numbers. So if you give me a pair of numbers like 1, 2, I can find the point in the plane. And the rule is you go over by the first number and then you go up by the other number. So maybe if again I'm using feet, up here is the point 1, 2. So if I did the point, say if I did -1, -1, the rule would be I would go in the other direction this way over to -1, and then I would go down to -1. So somewhere over here would be -1, -1. Then maybe a little bit further down here would be -2, -2, and over here would be -2, 0, etc. So even if you were blind, you could still talk about the plane. You could just say, well, it's just pairs of numbers. And what I'd like to say is how do you, this way of doing things, you might like to know how can you talk about distances between points in the plane. So I'm going to explain the formula for how you compute distances, and it's supposed to look like this. So I'll do an example first. Here, if you want to know the distance between, let me erase some of these other points and just pick these two, 1, 2 and 2, -2. Well, the way this is done is you're interested in finding out how long that line is. And you can make this right triangle, which looks like this. And this side of the triangle, it goes from 2 down to -2. And so the total length of this side is 4. And then this other one, it goes from 1 over to -2 over. So the total length of this one is 3. So I'll copy over the picture here. This is 3, and this is 4, and this is 5. Well, this is what it turns out. Let me explain where this comes from. What you do to get this is you take this squared. So I'll write this down. 5. The rule is that 5 squared is 3 squared plus 4 squared. So what you would do to compute this is you take this thing squared and you add it to this thing squared, and then that's the distance squared. So so how many of you guys have heard of the Pythagorean theorem? Lots of people. How many of you guys know why it's true? Okay, less people know why it's true. So what I'm going to do is very quickly I'm going to give you a proof of the Pythagorean theorem. This is my favorite thing in mathematics. So there's a million proofs of the Pythagorean theorem, and I'll give you one. Okay, so it works like this. You draw a square, and then you make a pinwheel inside. And you make it so that it's completely symmetric. So this one is, maybe this side is A, and this is also A, and this is also B, A, and A, and this is B. B, B, and B. And then this side in the inside, this is the mystery side, which you want to find out. So let's just call it C. So now you've got this thing, and it's got an area. And you might know for a square or a rectangle, the way you compute an area is it's just this times this, the base times the height. So for example, if it was made of individual squares, the total area is 6, and you notice that 6 is 3 times 2. So that's the formula for area of rectangles. And now I'm going to kind of relentlessly apply it. So I'm going to compute the area of this big square in two ways. Well, one way to do it is it's this times this. So area of the figure it's A times B, it's A plus B times A plus B. So the way you do this with numbers is that when you want to multiply these things together, you take this times this plus this times this plus this times this plus that times that. So you get A squared plus B squared plus AB plus BA. And AB and BA are equal to each other. So that's one way to compute the area of the thing. But the other thing you could do is you could compute the area of these five pieces individually. So the area, let's figure out the area of this thing. Well, this is I'll just draw it over here. Well, oops. If I stick two of these together, I get a B by A rectangle. So if I stick these two together, I get a B by A rectangle. And if I stick these two together, I get a B by A rectangle. So just coloring it in, if I just compute the area of these two, I get AB. And then if I compute the area of these two together, I get another AB. And finally, I have to compute the area of the inside. The inside's a square, and its area is C squared. So what you get out of this is the area of the whole thing is these two plus the one in the middle. So you get C squared plus AB plus BA. But then if you look at this formula, this thing over here, it's equal to this thing over here because they're both computing the same thing. So now what you can do is you can just cancel off the things that are the same. The AB cancels the AB, and the BA is the same as the BA. So what you're left with is the formula that A squared plus B squared equals C squared. So that's a mathematical proof of the Pythagorean theorem. So going back to this formula here, I'll just tell you how it works in general. If you have a point, maybe I'll just call this point x1, x2. In this example, it was 1, 2. And then over here, maybe you have y1, y2. Then if you make this triangle, then this is I'll use my formula. That's the formula I wrote down for the line. And then over here, of course, I already messed it up. It's the y's. So when I compute, eventually I'm going to get this right.
Can you write bigger?
Sure. So when I figure out this height, it's the x2 minus the y2, and I just make it so that it's positive. And if I want to figure out this one, so this is my A, and this is my B. And if I want to figure out what the length is over there, if this was C, C squared is A squared plus B squared. And so c squared is, well, a squared is just this minus this squared, and then b squared is that minus that squared. So c squared is just plus and then finally, c is the square root of so that's the formula. If you so the way it works is that you just I can just say it like this. You take your two points, and then you just take the difference of the second coordinates, that gives you one number over here. Then you take the difference of the other coordinates, that gives you the other number, then you square them both, add them up, take the square root. So the idea is that even if you didn't, if you couldn't see anything in the plane, you could still compute distances between points. So very quickly, I'll give you an example of how you could use this distance formula to figure something out without really trying to see it. So if you can see very faintly, I wrote down four numbers in advance because I figured I'd probably get them wrong if I tried to do this. But suppose someone just gives you these points. Say 2, 3, and 0, -1, -1, 2, and 3, 0. So these are four points in the plane. And we don't really know what they are yet because we haven't tried to draw them, but let's see if we can compute some distances between them. So what I'll do is I'll just kind of connect these things up by lines. This is just a diagram that's going to help me compute the distances. So for here, getting ready to use the formula, what the formula tells me to do is to subtract off, take the difference between these coordinates and square it, and then take the difference between these two coordinates and square it, and take the square root. So let's see. So the first difference is 2, and the second difference is 4. So the distance I would get would be square root of 2 squared plus 4 squared. And then here, the difference is 3, and the difference is 1. So the distance I would get would be square root of 3 squared plus 1 squared. And then this distance would be, well, this distance is 4, and this is 2. So square root of 2 squared plus 4 squared. And then finally, square root of 3 squared plus 1 squared. And then finally, there's more distances. Like the distance between these points here is square root of 3 squared plus 1 squared. And then finally, the last distance is same thing, square root of 3 squared plus 1 squared. OK? So I've computed all possible. This is what a computer might do. So now what you notice here is that, let's see. So now I'm going to erase these things, and I'm going to put what they are. So 2 squared is 4, 4 squared is 16. So this is square root of 20. This is 3 squared is 9, and 1 is 10. Square root of 9, I mean square root of 10. Square root of 10. Square root of 20. Square root of 10. So one thing you notice about these numbers is that all of them, there's only two distances you see altogether. And the other thing is that square root of 10 of 20, well, square root of 20 is, it's the square root of 10 times the square root of 2. That's the way square roots work. So I could equally well write this as square root of 2 times the square root of 10. And then again, square root of, so there's four of these points. If you put them in the right order, like if you go like this, then like this, and then like this, and then like this. These four make kind of like a circuit where the distance between each one and the next one is square root of 10. And then somehow the distance across ways is square root of 2 times that. So if I well, what could this be? What are these points? There's four of them that kind of go like this. Maybe, well, I'll try to draw a funny example. Say I tried to draw it like this. This certainly is a circuit of four points where all the distances are the same amount, but then if I go across, this is shorter than this. And if I really wanted to make them the same, the only figure that would do this would be a square. So just based on computing these distances, in fact, the only possibility is that it looks like this. And then this would be so this was a little illustration of how just using the formula for computing the distance and just knowing the names of the points, you can actually figure out what the thing is without actually trying to draw it. Okay, so there's one more thing I want to explain about the plane, and then I'm going to move to three dimensions. And the last thing I'm going to explain is sort of in the service of later explaining this four-dimensional thing. So the one more picture I want to show you in the plane, let's see, maybe over here, is so this will come up later, but I'll say it now. So if you have a bunch of points in the plane, imagine kind of a big crowd of points, then what you can do is you can, for each point, you can think that each point is kind of like the mayor of a city, and its city is all the points that are closer to it. So for example, for this point, all of everything in here would be in this guy's city, and up to here, then it's sort of in this other one, and then going out this way, I'm trying to draw so these are all the points in this one city, and then this one over here, maybe it looks like this. Anyway, this is in the line there isn't really much you can draw for shapes, but this is a nice way of drawing interesting things in the plane. You put down a bunch of points, and then you look at all the points that are closest to each of the individual points, and this will kind of break the plane up into different cities. Anyway, so this is going to come up later when I talk about higher dimensions, but I just wanted to mention that this is a neat way of producing shapes in the plane. Okay, three dimensions. Now it's not so easy to draw space anymore. Like, for example, we could think of it as this room, but it's easy if you just go the numerical route. You could just say space is just triples of numbers. And one system you could use for doing it is that, say, the first number would tell me how far to, say, move this way in the blackboard, and then the second number would tell me how far to move up, and then the third number would tell me how far to move out or back, depending on whether it was positive or negative. So maybe if I decided that 0 was over here in the corner, and I wanted to do the number 10, 10, 10, I would go out like this, and then up to there, and then out to about here. So this is about where the point 10, 10, 10 is. And if I wanted to know where 10, 10, 5 was, it would be about here. If I wanted to know where 20, 10, 5 was, it would be about here. 20, 10, 0 would be back here, and so on. And if you want to know, well, okay, this is great. Now we know how to describe points in three-dimensional space, but how do you compute their distances? And if you look at the formula here, this is how distance, let me just record this now. So distance, so I'll write it like this, line, plane, and space. If I had the points x and y, what was the distance? It was the square root of x minus y squared. And then in the plane, if I had points x1, x2, and y1, y2, then the distance between them was square root of x1 minus y1 squared plus x2 minus y2 squared. So suppose I had three points in space, say x1, x2, x3, and y1, y2, y3. So can you guess what the distance might be? Just probably put another, it's a little tricky to give a proof that it works, but you get x1 minus y1 squared plus x2 minus y2 squared plus x3 minus y3 squared. Okay, so anyway, there's a nice distance formula in space. Now I built some shapes in space. Like, let me describe the cube, or a cube for you. So it's a little tricky to draw a cube. I mean, here's a cube. I guess you can see this, and then maybe you can. So this is, that's a cube, and I'll put it like this. If you wanted to draw a cube, maybe like, it's hard to get it. Okay, there's a cube. And I can't really draw a cube in space because we don't have three-dimensional chalk. But I could say, I'll try to draw it as it is on the board and on the screen. You could imagine that this is kind of a flattened out picture of the cube, where you sort of imagine that you're kind of like staring into a room. Another view of the cube which you could do is you could draw squares like this. And then this is kind of like you're looking at the cube from the side. Now, another view of the cube is just this. This would be what would happen if you were looking very far away from the cube, straight at a face. So they're different pictures of a cube. Another one looks like this. These are all kind of pictures of a cube, things that you would see if you were looking at the cube. But you can describe it when, well, you can't describe all cubes this way, but one cube is like this. You could just say, you could just say the cube, or a cube, is the thing with these eight points as its corners. So one way to think about this is that, if you look at, say, this one, this one, the third coordinate is 0, and the other coordinates are 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. So my instructions would tell me to draw these four points in the square, in the plane. Maybe this is 0, 0, and 1, 0, and 1, 1, and 0, 1. And then for the other points, they're exactly the same as these, except the instructions tell me to come out of the blackboard by 1. So to draw the other ones, I'd put a point here, and here, and here, and here. And so just putting these numbers down builds a cube. Now you can figure things out about the cube even if you were blind. Like, let's think about the edges of the cube. Well, this is really, now I'll really try to draw this. But I'll draw it in kind of a modern art kind of way, maybe. I think I'm okay. Wait.
There we go.
Then, okay, that's the top and the bottom, and what's connected up by edges? Well, for the edges, I'm really just changing the third coordinate. So like 0, 0, 0 is also connected up to 0, 0, 1. And 0, 1, 0 is connected up like that. And this is connected up like that. And that's connected up like that. So this is a pretty weird picture of a cube. But you can just, if you couldn't see it, you could just say, if you notice that for all the edges, all that's happening is one of the coordinates is changing. Like for this edge, the middle one is changing to a zero. And this edge over here, the first zero is changing to a one. So the way you would say what the edges are in the cube is it's just you take two points that just differ by one coordinate. So you can answer questions about the cube, like how many edges does it have? Well, for something to change coordinates, one of the three positions has to change, and that gives you three choices. It could either the third one could change, or the second one could change, or the first one could change. But then when it changes, there's four possibilities for what the other two could be. They could either be 0, 0, or 0, 1, or 1, 0, or 1, 1. And so 3 times 4 is 12. And so there's 12 edges. So if you look at this thing, I'll take this cube over here. When the middle coordinate is when the third coordinate is changing, you've got these four edges here. And then when the second coordinate is changing, you've got these four edges going up. And then the third ones go like this. No, I guess they go, let's see, you can go like this or like this or like this. So that's how you can see 3 times 4 equals 12 edges of the cube. The other thing about the cube is that it's a perfectly symmetric thing. Now, you can kind of pick it up, and there's many different ways of turning it around and putting it back. In fact, let me just give you a quick argument that there's 24 ways, because one thing is you can move any point. If this is my favorite point, I can move it this way. I can move any of the eight corners to any of the other eight corners. And then once I've done that, I can turn it each of three ways. So sort of there's 24 different kind of ways of picking up the cube and putting it back on itself. It turns out that the cube is one of five platonic solids. These are these completely symmetrical shapes like this. Another one is the tetrahedron, which is just a pyramid where all the faces are triangles. And then a third one is a dodecahedron, this yellow thing, where all the sides are pentagons. Maybe that's too big. Well, I'll put the pyramid on here so you can see it. So there's the pyramid. The dodecahedron I can try to draw it, but I won't do a good job. Well, that's not bad. That's sort of like what the dodecahedron looks like if you were kind of it had a really, like, kind of somehow looking down in a tunnel at this thing. Then there's another one called the icosahedron, which is made of 20 triangles, and it's inside. It's the blue one inside. And the icosahedron and the dodecahedron have a special relationship with one another. If I hold them just right, if I take the yellow one. If I put corners at the centers of all the faces of the yellow one, I get the blue one. And if I put points at the centers of all the faces of the blue one, I get the yellow one back, except it's been shrunk. So this is a kind of an operation you can do to a shape. You can a polyhedron. You can put points at the centers, so to speak, of all the faces, and you can see what shape that makes. So. So for this one, the tetrahedron, what do you get if you put What do you think you get if you put points at the centers of the faces? So firstly, how many faces are there to this thing? Four, right? And so I would just get this new thing that had four corners. So what do you think it would be? Could it be a square? It could be a square, but it's kind of, if you think of it like this, it's got one point on the bottom and then it's got three points hovering above it. So it's really just an upside down version of the same thing that's been shrunk a little bit. So I'll try to draw this. Well, it's, well, maybe there's a point here, and a point here, and a point here, and then the fourth point is kind of out of the blackboard, and so it makes another one of these things. So you can make a chart. So you've got the cube, tetrahedron, the icosahedron. There's the dodecahedron, and then there's a fifth one which I didn't make. It's called the octahedron, and it's what you get if you start with a cube, and you put points in the centers of the faces. You get something that has eight corners, and six corners. I'll try to draw it. That's kind of what an octahedron looks like. The top part is like a pyramid with a square base, and the bottom half is a pyramid with a square base, and you just stick them together. It gets hard to see it, but just in terms of points, if you wanted to make an octahedron, you could just say it has the points 1, 0, plus 1, 0, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, minus 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1, and 0, 0, minus 1. So it's a thing, and these are at 6 points, and then you can compute anything you wanted to know just from the list of points. Okay, so let me rewrite this. So when you do this operation of putting the points in the centers of the faces and getting the new shape, when you take the icosahedron, the blue guy, you get the yellow guy. And when you take the yellow guy, you get the blue guy, at least up to changing the shape, the scale of it. And then for the tetrahedron, you get the same. And for the cube, when you do this for the cube, well, the cube, you get the octahedron. When you do it for the octahedron, you get the cube. So these guys switch. So somehow the tetrahedron is, you might say it's the nicest, because somehow when you do this operation, you get the same thing back. But the other ones, they switch, so somehow they're less symmetric. Another way to talk about maybe how these things are, some of these are more symmetric than others in a different way. For cubes, you can completely fill up space with cubes. You can just imagine kind of an infinite grid of cubes in every direction. And you can also fill up space with octahedra. What you do is you put down a layer of points in the plane, and then you come out of the board and you put a new layer of points. I'll just draw them like this. You put new points in the centers of where all the other points were, but you kind of pull them out of the board a little bit. And then you keep going like this. And somehow, I'll show you one of the octahedra. It's this, 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 and then there's a point behind it. And then the next one is kind of coming out. So you can also tile, you can also completely fill up space with octahedra. Yeah, question? What's that? Ah. No, no, it doesn't. Let's see. Yeah, so at each layer, okay, so. So there is a tiling of space by octahedra and tetrahedra, but it's, I don't think it's this one.
Yes, it is.
Well, let's, okay, let's, all right, let's, all right, let's debate this afterwards. Right. Yeah, does this really have? Yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe this is the tetrahedron right there. Okay. All right. So this one works anyway. All right, so I was wrong. Anyway, you can't do it with tetrahedra, and you certainly can't do it with dodecahedron and icosahedra. So these are somehow these aren't completely symmetric. Somehow the tetrahedron is the one where when you do this construction you get the same thing, and the cube is the one that tiles space. Okay, now for higher dimensions. So four-dimensional space, you could just think of it as a list of four numbers. And five-dimensional space, you could think of it as a list of five numbers, and so on, like that. So what would a four-dimensional cube be? It would just be all the points. Well, it would be all these binary strings of length 16. So the four-dimensional cube, whatever it would be, it would have these 16 corners to it, and then you'd get some number of edges where you just keep all the coordinates the same except the first one. So if you wanted to know how many edges a four-dimensional cube had, there are four choices for where the thing switches. There are four choices for where the coordinate switches, and then when it does switch, there's eight possibilities for what the other values are. So there's four times eight. There's 32 edges for the four-dimensional cube. So I thought. And then for the five-dimensional cube, anyway, there's how many corners do you think a five-dimensional cube would have? 32, right? And then the edges, how many edges would it have? Well, an edge would be something where you have all these numbers the same and just one number switches. So the choice for where the number switches, there's five choices. And then when one of the numbers switches, there's 16 different values for the other number. So of each type of edge going in one of the five directions, there's 16 choices. So there's this thing has 80 edges and so on. So I thought I would quickly show you a picture of what one way to draw. Let me just kind of quickly draw a four-dimensional cube. You could kind of draw. Okay, this is kind of a messy picture. I'm going to make up for it in a minute. But what I'm imagining is I'm connecting up all the points over here to all the other points over there. So I thought I would show you a picture of this. So this is a picture of what a four-dimensional cube looks like, and you can color it, and then you can watch it spin around. You can make it. So what this thing is doing is it's taking a four-dimensional cube. It's just giving it in terms of these points. And then it's just kind of pushing it down. It's trying to draw it on the blackboard, but it's drawing it from different points of view. So that's some picture of a four-dimensional cube. Okay, so now what I'll do is, now I'll show you what a six-dimensional cube looks like. Hold on, let's go down. I'll colorize it. So I've chosen six colors. If you did the same thing, you would have six numbers here. And to compute the number of edges, each one of six positions could change. And then there would be 32 edges of that thing. So this has six different colors and 32 different edges in each of those directions. Okay, so you can kind of hit it from different... Okay, I'll just leave that up so you can watch it. Now I finally want to get to this thing called the 24 cell, which is the thing. So in three dimensions, there's these five platonic solids. And the tetrahedron is special in one way because when you put the points at the center, you get another tetrahedron. And all the other ones, when you do that construction, they switch. So in that sense, they're not as good. But the cube is special in a different way. You can use it to fill up space with cubes. So I'm going to show you this four-dimensional thing. But there's none of these guys as special in both ways. Somehow they either they switch when you do the operation or that you can't fill up space with them. So here's this thing called the 24 cell. So it's got 24 points, and the points are like this. Here's one of the points, and maybe I'll do it like this. This is one of the 24 points, and then another one is. So this thing has it's got 24 points because there's six of these, and then for each possibility you're supposed to take plus plus and plus minus and minus plus and so there's 24 points, and the first thing I want to tell you is that when you can put you can try to figure out what the faces are of this thing. Like, if you have something like a square, its faces are line segments in one dimension down. If you have a cube, its faces are squares. And if you have a four-dimensional, this is supposed to be a four-dimensional solid body, where these are the corners. And you can start figuring out what some of the faces are. Like, for example, one way to get a face is you take all the points to be positive. Like, you can get 6 points by taking 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, and 0, 1, 0, 1. And then you can figure out what this thing is by computing distances between the points. Like, if you wanted to know, what's the distance between, say, this point and this point? Well, what you do is you subtract the coordinates, and then you sum the squares, take the square root. So this is, if I took these 2 points here, I would get a 0 and a 0 and a 1 and a 1. So the distance between these 2 points is square root of 2. And likewise, for some of these other points, the distance like between these 2 points is, well, you get a difference of 1 here, and a difference of 1, and a difference of 1, and a difference of 1. And so here you get a 2. And when you work it all out, what you get is you get a chain of 4 points where the distances are all square root of 2. And then there's a fifth point kind of up here, and then there's a point at the bottom. You get all these distances where they're square roots twos, but then you get some other points where the distances are twos. And this turns out to be a copy of the octahedron. So it turns out that this 24-sided figure has 24 faces, as it turns out, and they're all octahedra. So I thought I would quickly show you a picture of that. But maybe before I'll do, I'll show you this thing. Actually, you can actually draw an 8-dimensional cube. That's what an 8-dimensional cube looks like. Okay, now I'll show you the other one. So this one. So you see the white thing and the yellow thing? Those are two of the 24 faces of the thing, and they're both octahedra. And they're just kind of rotating around. Let's see, you can turn off the color like that, turn it back on. So this thing, then there are two things. So you've got this thing, this 24 cell. It's got these 24 points. It's got 24 faces. And that's a hint, maybe, that if you do this operation, where if you put a point in the center of all the faces, it works out well. And you can actually do this for yourself. What you can do is, once you figure out what the faces are, like these four, you can figure out what the center point is. And the trick is to take all the, just to average all the points. What I would just do is I would add up these lists of numbers, and then I would just divide by 6, and this would give me the point in the center. So here I would have, when I add these up, I get a 3, I get 3s in each position. And so the center of this face turns out to be 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2. That's the And it turns out that if I compute all the centers of the faces, I get points like this. And I also get these, it turns out. So this is the result of kind of a long calculation. But what you do is, once you identify what the 24 faces of this thing is, you take the 24 points and you write down what these are, and when you start computing the distances between them, you see that you get a copy of the 24 cell, but smaller. So the 24 cell is good, like the tetrahedron, that when you do this operation of making the smaller one, you get the same thing. So it's got one of the properties. And then it turns out, this is the last thing I'm going to say. It turns out it has the second property as well. You can actually fill four-dimensional space with the 24 cell. So I'm just very quickly going to tell you how to do that. What you do is, I mentioned a long time ago that if you put a bunch of points down in the plane, then you could think of each one as the mayor of a city, where it's all the points closer to that point than any other point. So what you can do is you put all the points in four-dimensional space which have integer coordinates, like 3, 5, minus 6, and 7. And all points like this, where all the coordinates are integers, and it'll fill up all of four-dimensional space with cubes, except they're four-dimensional cubes. And then what you do is you add more points by putting in the centers of all the cubes. So what's really great in four dimensions is that the distance from the center to a cube is the same as the side length of a cube. And so adding all the centers of the cubes, it gives you this entire grid of points in four-dimensional space. And now you can think of each one as being the mayor of a city. And you can look at all the points closer to that point in the four-dimensional cube. And this will completely fill up four-dimensional space with these 24 cells. So the thing about the 24 cell is that it's a completely symmetric object. It's like the cube or the tetrahedron or one of these. It's completely symmetric. And also, it's got this property which people call being self-dual. When you put all the points at the centers and you look at what you get the same thing, only smaller. And finally, you can fill up space with it. So it's sort of like an even more perfect object than the Platonic solids in four dimensions. So, I guess that's about, I had a few more things to say, but that's probably all I'm going to say, because it's out of time.